Hey guys, Emma here, also known as 8 Vinyl O, bringing you all another video. Today's video is finally, I've been wanting to get this out for a while. It's going to be my top 10 albums of 2020. Finally narrowed down the list. I really milked it out to the last possible, second to get this video up. It's almost the end of December. It's almost a new year, which, thank you. Finally, get to leave 2020 in hindsight and hopefully never hear about 2020 ever again, because wow. But you know what, for a terribly horrendous rotten year, it was a great year for music, and I'm also extremely excited for future music, future albums to come out of this year. So I think a lot of musicians had obviously some extra time to kind of sit, I'm assuming, right? And so I'm also excited for those albums, future albums, to get released as well. So, terrible year. I know I don't have to talk about it on here. I know that's not why you're here, but hopefully, like I said, it's almost the end. It's almost there. And here's to hoping that 2021 is a much better year for everybody. So, but with that, like I said, terrible year, but a great year for music. And I'm putting this up, right? Last possible, like, couple days before the end of the year. So obviously I really sat on a variety of different albums, sat on a bunch of different lists that I made, and really tried to narrow down what I believe to be the top 10 albums of the year. Coming up with a list, that's difficult. Then narrowing it down to 10, that's difficult. But the ranking, that's why I don't do a lot of ranking videos on my channel. I'll put out a Cheap Trick one eventually. I know so many people have asked about that. I'll do that eventually, but I feel like it changes anything that I rank, whether Cheap Trick or another band. I think Cheap Trick, though, I have it narrowed down. But, you know, other bands, things like that, it changes for me. It changes for me either every day, every week, maybe even revisiting it a year from now. I'm going to look back on some of these videos and think, why would I rank that there and rank this one there? But so I find ranking to be extremely challenging, but I think narrowing down the list that I have in the order that it is the best possible, is my belief, and the best possible kind of order, in my opinion, of my top albums and, you know, the ranking of those albums. So this is my top 10 albums of 2020. Again, right, it's my personal top 10 albums. It might not be the best albums, you know, for everybody of the year, the best music, but in my opinion, these are my favorite albums, releases of the year. So agree to disagree, it's music. I've really enjoyed watching other people's top albums of 2020 lists, because it just goes to show that everybody has different music taste and music opinions. So fantastic. Let's get into it. Here are my top 10 albums of 2020. Let's get going. All right, coming in at number 10 is the debut album from English singer-songwriter Westerman. This was released in June 2020 of this year, and it is called Your Hero Is Not Dead. This album is kind of an electronic, folk, indie, alternative album. And it's definitely an album that's extremely hard to explain in terms of genre and sound. It kind of goes everywhere, and that's what I think makes this album very good and very unique and experimental, because it explores that pop sound, it explores kind of the electronic folk sound, it explores a bunch of different avenues, and it commands you to listen, right? This isn't an album that you can just put on and kind of sit back and expect, you know, oh, it's a comforting melody and this, you know. It makes you listen, because every single song is completely different. It takes you to a bunch of different places. The lyrics are all over the place, but they're wonderful. So in terms of songwriter, this guy is extremely talented. And then, of course, not only the songwriting, but I think that his voice is very calming, very unique. And this is definitely an individual to keep an eye out for future releases, because if this album kind of if he declared to the world that he's Westerman, and this is kind of his declaration and introduction into the music world, then he did a phenomenal job. And I seriously cannot wait to hear more from this artist. So like I said, the sound is kind of all over the place. It is very much poppy, but then also experimental. The lyrics, the themes in this album cover everything from moral, ethical, political standpoints, different gray areas, kind of an exploration into your feelings and how you respond to certain things in terms of situations that might make you feel uneasy or uncomfortable, maybe different struggles, and then of course how you kind of respond and react to those things. So bunch of different avenues that this goes, a lot of different themes that this album kind of covers, and you know, the lyrics give you strong visuals from it kind of jumps around, like I said, makes you follow, and really kind of highlights what it means to live in the moment. So definitely my top 10 of the year. This one comes in at number 10, and you don't even have to believe me. Elton John, if you go on his Twitter, you can go on his Twitter right now. I'm not just making this up, okay? He actually cites this album as one of his favorite albums of the year, and even says that this debut album is better than his own. So, like I said, you don't have to believe me in terms of best albums. You can just go, you can go listen to Sir Elton John on that one. So, coming in at number 10, like I said, this is Westerman's debut album, Your Hero Is Not Dead. Check this one out. All right, coming in at number 9 of my top 10 albums of 2020. This one I know is going to be a little bit controversial. And I know this because I recently posted a video, my kind of initial thoughts video on my channel a couple of weeks ago when this was first released. And although a lot of people really liked this album, a lot of people also hated this album and were not afraid to share that in the comments of that video. So, like I said, controversial pick, but I love this album. That hasn't changed from my first kind of initial thoughts video that I put out. I think this is a fantastic album. Such a fun release by McCartney, and of course this is McCartney 3, released in December of 2020, and I'm so happy that I waited to make my list to make this video, because obviously this album made it. So if I put it out before, then this wouldn't have been on here, which would have been sad because it is one of my top albums of the year. So like I said, controversial. Some people love it, some people hate it. That's fine. I love it. Long-Tailed Winter Bird, the opening track of this album, really captivated me, hooked me in, and after that I was sold. So it's not, you know, I'm not saying it's like a masterpiece. I'm, you know, it's probably not, to be fair, like the, you know, one of the best albums of the year in terms of music, and definitely not lyrics. Yeah, the lyrics are a little but the instrumentation's great. But for me and how I enjoy this album and how much I've been listening to it recently, it's only fair that it makes my top 10 of the year. So McCartney 3, deep feeling, it's probably the standout track for me. I love it. I love that McCartney kind of experimented with this a little bit, wasn't afraid to embrace modern sound, and it's just a great album. So controversial, go ahead and get me in the comments, but number 9, McCartney 3. All right, coming in at number 8 for me is the debut album from the kind of power pop slash punk influenced band Midnight Callers. This is their album Red Letter Glow. This came out in October of this year, October 2020. And actually this was given to me a couple of months ago by Legendary Jim as VCLT. And I've listened to it and I've absolutely fallen in love with the sound of this band. I definitely cannot wait to hear more from this band. Like I said, they kind of have a punky edge to their music, but they're very much a power pop band, having cited obviously the Beatles, Tom Petty, Big Star as some of their influences, but also Cheap Trick. And I definitely hear Cheap Trick in this album, which is probably why it made my top 10 albums of 2020. So it definitely has Cheap Trick influence in this album. A couple songs I genuinely could believe and see Cheap Trick having written and performed. Obviously not a Robin Zander voice, a unique voice in its own, but just the sounds, the melody, the riffs, the hooks, all of it, the lyrics definitely remind me of Cheap Trick. There's one song on here especially that I really think kind of incorporates that Cheap Trick sound. Like the first time I heard it, I was like, this is seriously Cheap Trick. And that is number 4, track number 4, I Need You. so good and so Cheap Trick sounding. So as a Cheap Trick fanatic, as the Cheap Trick fan that I am, of course, I really, really love this album. It is a rocker of an album. Playful melodies, catchy lyrics, you guys will love this. Amazing harmonies. So if you're into more of a, you know, a rocker type power pop album, then I definitely recommend listening to this because this is good stuff. And if you like Cheap Trick, The Beatles, Petty, Big Star, you will love this album. Go give it a shot. Number 8, top 10 of the year. All right, coming in at number 7 is the first solo release by this artist. This is called Stay Alive by Laura Jane Grace, and this is probably my favorite kind of surprise album of 2020. This is definitely kind of your quarantine isolation theme record. Of course, Laura Jane Grace, most well known from the band Against Me, also does a side project called Laura Jane Grace and the Devouring Mothers. They're fantastic. I saw them live, amazing in concert. I've met Laura Jane Grace. She's a very wonderful, nice individual, so sweet. So I have nothing but nice things to say about Laura Jane Grace and her music. So when this dropped, this was a surprise, and I got a text from my friend who also loves Laura Jane Grace and was like, this just happened. And it was a surprise, and I was blown away. So of course I listened to it. I fell in love with it right away. The themes, the lyrics are very timely. They cover everything from, of course, isolation and quarantine, to longing to travel, to social justice and white supremacy. There's a song on here, a standout track, in my opinion, called Hanging Tree, which explores white supremacy in the United States, something definitely that needs to be talked about and discussed, and Laura Jane Grace definitely brings a platform to that, which I think works beautifully on this album. And the song's beautiful and haunting at the same time. Well, the song's not beautiful. I like the sound, but the lyrics are extremely haunting, and the theme is very... you know. Anyway, a great album, great album. Just her on this album, her first true solo release. It was just her voice, a guitar, a drum machine pedal, I think, I don't know, or a drum machine. No computers, no overdubbing. It was produced by Steve Albini, and you know how Steve Albini likes that raw, organic sound. It was recorded in 2 days, and just a wonderful surprise release. You know, Laura Jane Grace is wonderful at evoking emotion with her voice, even in softer sounding songs. So even though it, you know, all of these songs are acoustic and it has more of that acoustic feel to it, depending on the lyrics, right, where you have powerful lyrics, you need powerful sound to accompany that. Her voice does a really, really amazing job in amplifying that. So, Laura Jane Grace, Stay Alive, and of course, just the title, right? Staying Alive, sometimes, whether she explores isolation or social justice or just plain staying alive, it's definitely a timely record. So, Laura Jane Grace, Stay Alive, number 7 of my top albums of 2020. All right, coming in at number 6 is the 4th studio album from American singer-songwriter Blake Mills. He's also a producer, composer, and just an incredibly amazing guitar player. So this is called Mutable Set. This was released in May of 2020, and I just kind of was exposed to this album a couple of months ago, and of course then I had to get it on vinyl after listening to it. But this is the first album that I truly kind of dived deep and explored a little bit of Blake Mills. I've heard of Blake Mills before, a very notable individual, especially in the modern day music scene, has worked with a handful of notable musicians, produced a handful of albums, played on a handful of albums, one of which I'm going to be showing in this video, Bob Dylan's Rough and Rowdy Ways. He played guitar on that. So he definitely gets around, but this is really the first time. So I've heard the name before, but this is the first album that I've actually explored Blake Mills and his own solo projects and releases. So best way I could describe this album is kind of dreamlike. It's a calming album. It has very much kind of a calm vibe to it. It's also extremely raw and organic and highlights, right, Blake Mills' guitar playing, which is phenomenal. So if you're into kind of that soft sounding guitar, amazing guitar playing, then this is definitely the album for you. But even with kind of that calming sound to it, the lyrics and themes that are being explored in this album aren't necessarily calming. So I kind of like that contrast in this album. It explores everything from like people and experiences in our modern world, right, our modern life, to things like disappointment, and more fitting and timely to today, right, this idea of isolation, and isolation from people and things. So definitely explores a variety of themes in our modern world, but just a raw, organic, beautiful album, kind of comes with an experimental edge to it. So it bounces around. A lot of these albums that I've been showing, right, doesn't have like one strict sound. It's kind of experimental, it bounces around, it's very fluid. And that's why I think that I really, really enjoy this album. For Blake Mills, I kind of see this as a very individual, personal album. It's very much intoxicating to listen to. He has a very calming, soft voice. And then of course his guitar playing is incredible, just blows this album and makes it great. So it's a calming listen. And when this finished, I wanted more. So if that's not a good sign for an amazing record, I don't know what is. So Blake Mills' Mutable Set, I definitely recommend checking him out if you haven't already. I think you'd really be blown away by this album. So number 6, top albums of 2020. All right, number 5 for my top albums of 2020. This is the second studio album from this band, this kind of post-punk sounding band. This is Fontaines DC out of Ireland. And this is their album called A Hero's Death. They released their debut album not too long ago, I think maybe a year and a half now. Very much has that kind of post-punk sound. This album is a little bit different. They definitely experimented a little bit with this. They explored kind of different sounds and different genres in this album that I think ended up working out great. I know that a lot of people who were fans of their first album may have been disappointed with this album because it is a different sound, but I think that it worked wonderfully. So that's just my opinion. So right, post-punk band, but this album in particular kind of explores psychedelic aspects and psychedelic sounds than they did in their first album, which they didn't. For example, they cite influences from the Beach Boys in this album for that more kind of dreamlike feel and dreamlike sound. This album is very, very complex and explores a variety of different themes as well, which has been a common theme in all of these albums that I've been showing. Again, timely lyrics talking about the complexities and uncertainties of our world, and has kind of that edgy, dark vibe to it, a psychedelic vibe, an edgy, dark-sounding vibe, but also incorporates their post-punk sound, and I think they do a wonderful job with all of that. Within this album, you can also kind of hear a little bit of The Smiths, and I think even more so, Joy Division. So it also incorporates a little bit of that. So if you're into The Smiths, Joy Division, The Pixies, if you're into those type of bands, I think you'd really, really dig this release. This album is definitely ambitious. Like I said, it's experimental, especially coming off their debut album. It's truthful, though, I really think that the lyrics are truthful and very personal and individual, and I think that it worked. So one of my favorite songs off here, a notable track, is called Televised Mind. Very, very, very unique, kind of edgy track off of this album, and I really enjoyed it. So number 5, Fontaines DC, A Hero's Death. All right, coming in at number 4 is the debut released, self-titled release from the band The Third Mind. Third Mind is a supergroup that was created by Dave Elvin, who also lends his guitar and vocals to this album. It's kind of the brainchild of Dave Elvin, and this was first introduced to me by Steve Carlson right at the beginning of the year. It was released in February of 2020, so even before everything hit. And I said then that it was probably going to be in my top albums of the year, and it stayed true. I love this release. I love this album. So what Dave Elvin wanted to do is he was inspired and influenced by the Bitches Brew sessions, of course, Miles Davis, where you just grab a group of really talented musicians, throw them into a room, give them a key, and press record, and kind of jam out and, you know, experiment a little bit and just do kind of a instrumental jam. So that's basically the feel of this album. It has a psychedelic, folky, acid rock type feel to it. It covers anywhere from Alice Coltrane to 13th Floor Elevators. And then, of course, my favorite track, most notable track on this album, in my opinion, is a 16-minute version of Paul Butterfield Blues Band East West. So it's only six tracks, but it runs 44 minutes. And if you're into kind of experimental, instrumental, jamming, psychedelic, acid rock, folky sound, you will love this album. So I love it. It makes number four for me on my top albums of 2020, The Third Mind. All right, coming in at number three, we're in the top three now. This is a band I recently discovered over the past few months. This is a band called Krungbin, coming out of Houston, Texas, a trio, a wonderful, wonderful trio. And this is their third studio album that was released in June of this year. If you haven't heard of Krungbin before, they kind of blend and they're influenced by a variety of different genres and music. They have diverse global influences, cultural influences. It's anywhere from Indian folk rock to psychedelic sound to Latin American sound to Jamaican dub to surf sound. I don't even know if I said that yet. I could just keep going to soul to funk. This album's definitely has a funky vibe to it. And it's all over the place, and I love it. They're mostly an instrumental band, but they do incorporate more lyrics in this album than their previous releases, and I think the lyrics are fine. Some people were back and forth about if they thought that they should add the lyrics or not, or if they prefer their other albums, which really don't incorporate lyrics. I think it works out absolutely fine. I don't think it distracts from the music at all. I think it actually adds an element to it that makes it very unique. But what a diverse record. It has a chill vibe to it. It's very relaxing and laid back. It also has a moody, energetic sound depending on what track you're listening to. And like I said, I love that kind of diverse global cultural influences that they put into this album. So I cannot say more good things about this band and this album. You're gonna just have to check it out yourself. That's the best way I can explain it. So Krungbin, Mordecai, my top three, number three album of the year. All right, coming in at number two, I've talked about this album a lot. This is, of course, Bob Dylan's Rough and Rowdy Ways, his 39th studio album and first release for him for years. So this was kind of a controversial album too, not so necessarily by the critics. I think everybody really liked this album, which of course I think it's one of his best. But in the vinyl community, it's kind of back and forth, and I still know people and have conversations with people who just don't get it. And that's fine. I'll be honest, my first listen, I wasn't sure. It just took one, though. So after my first listen, when I got into my second and third and so on, I cannot get enough of this album. I think that it is incredible, and like I said, probably one of my favorites from Bob Dylan. So, and that's saying a lot. I don't even need to get into genre, right? Americana, folk, bluesy feel. Definitely a very bluesy feel to this album. It includes contributions from musicians that I've talked about or am going to talk about in this video. Like, I'll give you a hint, Fiona Apple, who we still need to hear about, and Blake Mills, who I mentioned, I think, for number six with his record Mutable set. So has a kind of a nice array of musicians performing on this record. The recording process, right, was very kind of spontaneous, which is Bob Dylan's style. I think that even though his voice, right, is going a lot, I think he delivers and does with his voice exactly what he should. So I don't think he pushes it or does anything that I think didn't work. I think it did work. False Prophet, obviously a notable track off of here for me. I really enjoy that song. I like Goodbye Jimmy Reed. And then of course The Back with Murder Most Foul, which was kind of that surprise release, surprise song that we didn't see coming from I don't even remember now when that was. Anyway, So like I said, nice delivery of vocals. The sounds and arrangements are wonderful on this record. I really like the themes. I really like kind of the exploration into pop culture. And you definitely hear that on Murder, Most Foul as well. But you just get poetic Bob Dylan and his very intelligent mind exploring different themes and cultural references where he basically commands you to keep up with him. So, Rough and Rowdy Ways, my number two album of the year by Bob Dylan. All right, coming in at number one, my top album of 2020. This was a no-brainer for me. This reigned supreme the entire time I was going through my list and going back and forth and what order should I do and what album should I add, and this one was just always on top. So this was a no-brainer. Of course, this is the fifth studio album from Fiona Apple, and this is Fetch the Bolt Cutters, one of her first releases in years. Took years to make this album, and it was finally released this year. Of course, I think it was released a little earlier than expected because of quarantine and everything that was happening kind of towards the beginning of the year, so she gave us this as a gift. But what an amazing album. I have nothing but good things and nice things to say about this release, which is probably why it is my top album of the year. But it's definitely a unique experimentation, exploration into a personal and individual approach on life for Fiona Apple. This is kind of her, I have stuff that I want to say and I'm going to say it how I want to say it, and that's what's going to happen. That's how I kind of feel about this album, and I feel how she felt about this album and the music and what the lyrics are and what she's saying. So it's experimental. It's not conventional, right? It's not her conventional sound. It's more brave and more bold. The common theme in this album is freedom of oppression, right? Not being silenced, a refusal to be silent. So like I said, I think that Fiona Apple had something to say and she said it. So I love this album. I love everything about it. I love all the risks that she took. I love the sound. I love the avant-garde percussion kind of feel to it. I love everything about this record. I have not one negative feeling about this album. Intimate lyrics, it's tender, it's funny, it's angry at times, and like I said, it's brave, it's bold, and it's very, very unique. So Fiona Apple, Fetch the Bolt Cutters, my top album of 2020. All right, so those are my top 10 albums of 2020. Like I said, it's my own personal rankings, how I personally feel about those albums. They might not be the best, right? Critically acclaimed best. I know that, of course, some of these albums did receive a lot of praise, but some of these are definitely unique. So I'm not saying they're the best albums of all time or the best releases of the year, but they're my personal favorites. So let me know what you think down below, what some of your favorite albums are, especially if you aren't in the vinyl community making videos and doing these kind of top 10 discussions. I still want to hear what you thought about this year in terms of music, so definitely let me know. But with that, guys, especially if I don't see you until the new year, stay safe, be well. Here is to 2021, and I will see you guys very soon. Bye, guys.